So I went and saw the new Top Gun movie. And I know that everyone's probably going to see it at one point or another. So I was just going to talk about things that everybody else might not talk about. And basically leave the open-ended question of why. And what happens next, if this is the way the future of movie making is going to be. I'm just reading this, news update about how, the first 4 days of release of Tom Cruise has the biggest opening, of Tom Cruise's career. So you got the weird, obvious fact that it's Saturday. So if it opened yesterday, how is that 4 days? And then they're just saying how, it beat out Pirates of the Caribbean at like 150, or I mean, Pirates of the Caribbean was like 139 million, and then this is like 150 million or something like that. But it hasn't even been 4 days. So it's just weird because seemingly the government wants it to be Tom Cruise's biggest opening. Not necessarily that it really was the biggest opening. And I just find that strange. So if you do see it, I just kind of wanted to have the conversation so that you can kind of feel like you have a friend. Because you're going to notice some inconsistencies. Like, for instance, well, if you like a slightly bent over version of a really, really hot brunette, like 60-year-old dude, he just kind of seems like he opens up the entire movie sort of slightly bent over, like he takes it in the ass. Or when he did, it still kind of left this broken bone down there, so just slightly bent forward. And then, if you're gonna technically put a white shirt on, make sure it's the cheapest one that they sold at Target. Because there is heavy cotton, and then there is really, really light cotton, and then there's lighter than that. And Tom's wearing that. It's really dirty, it's really tight. The sort of sleeves on the arms don't even go very far down. And it just is the kind that most guys say, "I hate this shirt. I hate wherever you got it. Don't get me my undershirts anymore." It's one of those. I mean, it's kind of a big deal. Most guys know about the whole, "I want to wear a white undershirt," or "it's going to be white shirt day," that kind of thing. Well, this one is the only ones that we don't like. And it's the cheapest of the entire group. It's probably Fruit of the Loom. And it just is his sort of like paste on really, really cheap shirt while he's, working on something. Then you get a wide view of his, like fixer-upper garage or whatever. And that's where you get sort of the view of like the perma-fuck. And he just doesn't seem to understand the concept of putting on pants that don't make him look like the way a girl puts on pants, which is as tight as you can to show where it is the pee-pee goes inside the vagina. I'm like, "Yes, that's my vagina." That's a good reason for girls to wear tight pants. And you got a situation where he's like slightly bent over and they're really tight. And, adding the cheap white shirt, and then he arches one leg high in the air, and then he sort of lands on the other side of this caramel niggered out seat, and then he opens up a beer or something. And it's really, really suggestive to start the whole movie. You got Cuba Gooding Jr. and all of his friends just laughing their asses off, like all the way back from Jerry Maguire. It's been like 36 years or something since the first Top Gun movie, only to have all the niggers laugh about what came after Top Gun, which was Jerry Maguire. Because, you know, once you go black, you don't go back. In Tom's case, you do, but... well, whatever. Anyways. You have basically a situation where after all of that, he's got to find out that he's going to be the teacher for all of the top guns that were selected to go to this one school. Well, gets down to the facility and he finds out that Goose, who's white with blonde hair, and Meg Ryan, who's extremely white with blonde hair, had a Mexican hairlet baby. Everyone knows what a hairlet is, right? Well, basically the baby is born with the lip that's touching the bottom of the nose, and they gotta actually slice into it, cutting it wide open and then bringing it down and stitching it back closed. Hopefully nobody notices that much. And in this case, he grew a porn stash to be Goose's and Meg Ryan's son. Dark skin to give off the impression of the Mexican mafia. A porn stash to give off the impression of an active porn star Mexican mafia. And then Tom Cruise has to suck a Mexican mafia dick. Kind of giving off the impression of Made in America, where he basically was a Mexican drug lord and did just a reality sort of tribute to an actual person that did airplane drops of marijuana. It's really shocking to watch, but Tom Cruise is a drug dealer. Everyone gets to see Tom Cruise as a huge drug dealer. Gets his tooth knocked out when he goes to Mexico. He gets picked up in jail. And then he's basically still going to go on to do some more Mission Impossible movies after Made in America. And then now he does this movie. And instead of having a white son, this guy and this girl have a Mexican mafia son with a hair lip and a porn star. And instead of sucking Cuba Gooding Jr.'s dick, apparently he's got to pay tribute to the Mexican mafia. No one knows where Tom Cruise is, but he likes dudes and dudes in powerful positions just to give his salute to, I actually am not that cool. I didn't do that, you know, teenage awesome movie, you know, whatever it's called. All the right movies. You know, that's not me. And, you know, kind of taking it away from every sort of American boy's dream about meeting a girl in the neighborhood or, you know, all that good stuff basically panned out the window to, you meet a white brunette, you better watch out. Because they either want to suck a nigger dick right now, or if there's a Mexican family in the neighborhood, he's probably thinking about going over there and asking him if he can help out, pass out marijuana. So anyways, he's got the job to basically take this kid who's very aggressive, because apparently Tom Cruise, in his position before he was asked to be a teacher, was in a position to look over files, and he held this guy back from getting in some kind of pilot placement by dismissing his paperwork and then basically causing him to be 4 years behind his original plans. And eventually he did still make it to Top Gun, and 4 years or 5 years previous to this, this is what happened. And so obviously this kid doesn't like Tom Cruise. He knows that it's his dad's friend. He knows that his dad died because of some misunderstanding about what went down when Goose, you know, was trying to eject and then broke his neck trying to eject hitting the top of the thing. You know, whose fault was it? Well, add the fact that he held back his paperwork and Tom Cruise is in hot water. But I guess, ultimately, what I'm getting at, you know, is where else the movie goes. You know, meeting all the other Top Gun candidates. All the other winners that are basically put in a scenario where they got to do a live mission. So instead of going to Top Gun and being trained who's the toppest of the Top Guns, they're all basically put in a group-like scenario to go on a live mission. And then Tom Cruise, being Top Gun, has to train them. Or as Tom would tell you, actually I was second place. So it's a really dynamite movie that basically shows every chance they get when they're not giving him the boy next door look when he obviously worked hard on his, you know, Botox or plastic surgery to look 18 again. You get the really noticeable, queered out, full body version. And you know what? Why play a football game in the beach when you can play offense and defense at the same time? No one's really ever heard of it, but you get a lot of laughter because there's no actual rules. So you just basically have a lot of gay people on steroids and one girl, where he's basically trying to win everybody over because he kind of got in trouble with all of them. And with no rules playing a football game, you just eventually end up reaching over and feeling a dick. And then nobody's to blame because everybody's just hot. And without actually showing any penetration after the game, you just get a lot of laughter and slow motions. So once they've all queered themselves by letting go of all of their juices inside of each other, they then have to do a mission. Well, essentially, I guess I'm just a little frustrated because with all of the things that I've said, it's the number one Tom Cruise movie out there, while advertising for a lot of suggestive metaphors to his, like, shadier areas of his career. Not anything to do with anything being, like, heroic or, you know, the American way of just pre-adolescence and meeting a girl or how you should talk to somebody. Just where his movies went towards Tom isn't as Tom as Tom thinks. And then exploiting it further into this movie about him not being Top Gun, but training other people to be Top Gun and doing an actual live mission. So you're gonna go see it and you're gonna see, technically from the movie, The Girl Next Door. And one of the kids has a specific face. He's blonde. And he ends up being like one of the guys that's supposed to be in this porno. He's got this great idea to, you know, get all of these hot guys over here and then get all these hot girls over here and then during a school dance do a porno in one of the classrooms. Makes a reprising role in Top Gun. Looks just like him. Everybody knows there's only one guy that looks like that walking around, and it's from the movie Girl Next Door. Well, they went and found him. And, you know, basically going against the movie The Girl Next Door, they made him save Tom Cruise and his Mexican mafia hair-lit dead best friend's son. Yeah, he saves the day. So you just have a lot of people that are there to say what Tom isn't, when Tom isn't showing what he could control. Meaning, Tom's saying, I know they're gonna fuck me, I know they're gonna screw me, I know I'm not gonna get the right size clothes. I'm gonna do the only thing that I have control over, because they can't come into my house. I'm going to go to the doctor's office. I'm going to get surgery. I'm going to work out. I'm going to look like the way I think I should look. And Tom looked good. I was surprised. And everything else that Tom couldn't control was metaphorical, was gay, was bad acting, across the board. And if you believe everything they're telling you, I really question where the world is going, because they are really backing up that the teenage American brunette that you know in your neighborhood, he's gay. And now they're all scared. You know? Which one of the girls that I'm going to meet is going to throw a Mexican mafia marijuana guy my direction and say, help me distribute drugs? Or if there's a nigger that is in the neighborhood and the brunette guy does something to make the girl just feel like upstaged, she's just going to go get him and then make him stand really close. And that brunette's going to be so scared. He's going to be sucking a nigger dick, no problem. Really just doesn't leave much room of the American brunette teenage boy. A lot of people get paid when Jesus Christ is again removed from the American scenario. And I guess I always wonder why the future always has one Sunday, one day out of the week, dedicated to the American brunette that was removed by everybody that was second place when they watched how it was done, how it was supposed to be done, how it looked best the first time. And give it 30 years and you have second place people everywhere that all bond together and group together to just basically tell the kids ahead of time, don't plan on first place, because then you're a target too. So I guess when you have Hollywood and you have New York and you have terrorism, it's just a lot easier if there never is Superman.